I'm Catherine Verhenna and I live and work in Nottingham, and I've worked with people who've had laryngectomy surgery for about 21 years now. So that's me.
And so these questions are going to be so good, so easy for you to answer. I'm going to jump straight into it if I may. So when somebody's had a laryngectomy, what can you talk about what anatomy and physiological changes we'll see after a laryngectomy?
Yeah, of course. So when I'm explaining this, I really like to explain that although it's called the voice box, the larynx also has other important functions. So there'll be changes to the way that people speak, and there'll also be changes to the way that people breathe and the way that people swallow. So I guess the biggest change that people see, and I think the thing that's foremost on people's mind when they're thinking about this surgery, is that during the laryngectomy surgery, the voice box is removed and the windpipe is brought into an opening, which is called the stoma, just at the front of the neck here, so that the two kind of pipes are not connected anymore. You've got the windpipe coming out to the front, and then the gullet, the esophagus, is just separate, so that people then can't choke as they swallow, but there's no connection to the upper airway, so people don't breathe through their nose anymore, which is obviously a big change. And I know we're going to talk a little bit more about the implications of all of those changes. And with regard to the kind of added changes, if you think people have to be very careful about water not entering the stoma, and there are changes to the way, because people aren't connected anymore to the nose, there are changes in smell and taste. So those are the biggest changes.
Can you sort of please describe to me then the options? You've talked about the voice box being removed. Mm-hmm. So what options does a person have for having a voice or communicating after a laryngectomy?
Yeah, sure. So there are three main options. And the first one, which can be perhaps a backup or it can be a primary source of communication, is a handheld electrolarynx that can be held either to the side of the neck or to the cheek. And that makes a vibration sound that is then shaped by the mouth. And it can be easy to use post-surgery. Not everybody can have the other forms of communication option, and this one can be accessed by most people. It can be difficult to accept the sound of an electrolarynx. So working with people about getting used to that sound and family and friends getting used to it is important. So that's the first one. The second one is something that we call esophageal voice, and that's kind of swallowing a little bit of air and bringing it back, and it vibrates as it comes past a muscle in the throat. And that can be taught and people can learn it, but it can be quite intensive to learn it. It takes quite a lot to learn it. It can be difficult to hear over background noise. And I think the thing to say is that not everybody masters it easily. It can be very intensive. It can be quite tiring. And so the third option, which then uses a similar principle of air vibrating in the throat, is this tracheoesophageal voice, which indeed you have, Alan, and that's using this little silicon voice prosthesis that's inserted into a passage at the back of the trachea, and air passes through that passage, vibrates in the back of the throat there, and you shape the sound to make this very natural sounding voice that you have.
Well, thank you for that. I do try. It's interesting that you've talked about when we think about the voice box, like that the actual larynx itself is just a vibrating little.
Exactly. It's a sound source, isn't it? It's two little muscles that just vibrate and let the sound be generated as air passes through. So you have to replace that.
Well, so once you remove that, we have to then create another vibrating source. So the electrolarynx is the vibration in the actual machine.
Exactly.
Whereas just the esophageal speech is the vibrations that you're creating with the airflow. Perfect. And my voice is created through the vibrations in my esophagus.
Exactly. Just in the back there. Yes, absolutely. So it isn't the voice prosthesis itself, it's the muscle at the back.
these three aspects, what will a person have to do in order to master these? I mean, would it just happen, or does a person have to practice and train?
Yeah, I would say for all of those, you have to practice and train. So if we take them in order again, with the electrolarynx, you need to learn how to master various things, working it, how you hold it, where you find the best spot to get vibration, mastering the kind of on off of the sound source so that you're really setting up for success for somebody to understand, and practicing, I guess, flexibility of intonation, which can come with these electrolarynx. And indeed, they can be put into a little kind of holder device so that you can use them hands free. So it can take a while. And I think one of the issues with the electrolarynx can be building confidence. So the work around working with somebody to rehabilitate can be, you know, saying, okay, we're going to think about where feels easiest for you to start using that. It might be with family and friends, but it might be outside somewhere. It might be on the bus or ordering a drink or in a shop. Where does it feel easiest to start using it? So I think that aspect of that rehabilitation comes with the electrolarynx. The esophageal speech, as I've said, that can be really quite intense. That can be therapy 2 or 3 times a week. It can be a lot of practice away from the therapy sessions, really trying to master that technique and build it up into a really good communicative option. And the third option, the tracheoesophageal voice, I'll be interested to know your experience a little bit. But once you've got the okay to go ahead and start using the voice prosthesis, you can set off pretty much straight away, can't you? But the skill in using the voice prosthesis, as I think you probably have found, is that you have to master the breathing to some extent, how to control the breathing so that you can talk as long as you might want to, how to not use too much effort as you use it, how to stay natural, all of those things. So, and again, I guess with all of those options, the rehab can also be establishing confidence. So people getting used to that slightly different sound and how it feels and how their partners, their family may react and how other people may react. So it's a lot about all of those aspects, I think.
That's really, really good to hear. I mean, I think, you're absolutely right. And I think it doesn't stop. I think practicing doesn't stop. You know, I think for me personally, if I want to carry on having a good voice, then every day I will practice and I will listen to my voice and I will use my breathing, like you said, and think about the pressure I'm using. But I also, I think it's also natural for people to use esophageal speech as well for yes, no.
Yes, you know, yes, yeah.
Or to answer, so not now, oh yes. You know, and it'd be, and that seems to come over time. The more you practice, the easier it is as well. You know, and there are times where you think you've got a cold and you don't want to, and the electrolarynx has its place as well. Yeah. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, so I think what you said is absolutely quite enlightening.